Uganda produces a wide range of agricultural products, and some are used for home consumption, whereas others are for commercial purposes. And indeed, a report by the International Trade Organization established that Uganda's land is able to feed 200 million people should it be developed for agricultural purposes. Tonight on How to Make Money, I visited Caro, who is minting money from making spices and herbs. Welcome to the set.
Thank you so much
for making time.
Thank you.
What spices do you deal in, and what inspired your decision, considering that spices growing in Uganda is not as popular as other cash crops like coffee?
Thank you. My name is Caro Mumba, and I'm the founder for Spices, Akari Natural Spices and Herbs. I love spices, and what has inspired me is actually a personal story. A few years back, like nearly 2 years back, I had a thyroid, like a goiter, and I kept on taking medication for quite some time, and it wasn't working for me. And then I read somewhere, actually just read somewhere about spices, about natural products for treating thyroid, and I gave it a try. I used, these are some of the spices I make. I have very many different spices. I have turmeric, I have cloves, I have guava, that's a herb. I have coriander, there are very many. Yes, but this is turmeric. This is one of the spices I use to treat me, actually. I mix it with some other herbs and spices, and it really worked for me. So when I saw it work, I said, why not try it? Why not help others as well? Because mostly I insist on using spices as something you can ingest orally, like a tea, rather than cooking. You can use it for cooking, but you don't have to overcook it. When you overcook it, almost all the nutrients go. So I advise people normally to take it as a tea. So I took mine as a tea, and that's what inspired me. That's what inspired me, yes. When I took the spices, I got better and better and better.
In terms of time, of labor, of space, of, you know, gardening, what really do you have to do as a farmer starting out in this?
Yeah, it takes quite some time. Spices take longer than other spices, yeah, but because of that, and sometimes because of demand, I buy the spices that are ready, like the seeds. Sometimes I buy seeds that are not yet dry, and I dry them myself and then grind them. Sometimes I actually buy dry seeds, yes, like I buy that from the market. And I have a few suppliers, farmers, who actually grow. I don't grow it in abundance, like a lot. I grow a little bit. Mostly I buy from farmers. Yeah, I buy from farmers and I dry it. It doesn't, if you buy seeds, it doesn't take a long time to dry, because I have a dryer. A day is enough for me to dry and then grind it as well. So let's say 2 days, I'm good to go. Yes.
So all your spices are dried in the dryer and not the natural sun?
No. All of them are dried in the dryer. And the dryer is natural because it uses briquettes. Yes, it uses it. So it dries it naturally. So all the nutrients are contained in there. Yes.
And so trading in, for example, coffee, cocoa, and other mainstream cash crops, commercial crops, is quite easy because those are widespread and we know about them. So when it comes to spices and herbs, how do you do that? Like, how have you found trading in herbs and not other crops?
I found trading in herbs and spices a little bit challenging, but then people are picking up. Today, people want to live like healthy lives, and they prefer using like the local herbs and not the like medicine. Yes, they do medication, but these days people are slowly turning to herbs and spices. Yeah. So at first it was a little bit challenging, but I'm getting there slowly. People are getting to love it.
But what are some of the challenges you encounter in your entire production process and when you get your spices onto the market? But also, how big is your market so far?
So far my market is not that big, although I have a few even outside the country. I have a few markets here and there. It's not yet so big, but it's getting there. For the last 2 years, getting it that I started my business right before COVID or lockdown. During lockdown, the business was going well, but I had a challenge of accessing raw material because of the lockdown. So sometimes I could get demand because basically most of the things that I trade in, the herbs and the spices, they were on demand during the COVID time. Yeah, so I got some orders, but I had a challenge of raw materials and accessing raw materials since I couldn't get to the market, or if I got to the farmers, they couldn't deliver because of transport and all that. Yes, but in general, people are picking up and it has been fine. It has been okay.
How much do you buy the raw materials? And where do you get the farmers? Do you have like a group where you go to collect all your spices, or do you just outsource and like, you know, pick them from whoever is willing to give?
No, I have particular farmers. How I got them on groups, I just pick them on groups, some on Facebook. And then from the market as well, I have particular people I buy from, because sometimes if you buy from everybody, sometimes you don't get quality. So I stick to a few people. I have a few people in the market, and a few farmers, but I got them off groups on Facebook, and then friends, recommendations, things like that. And a few of the spices, actually, I bought them from Tanzania.
You mentioned that you have a bit of challenges with, of course, dealing in spices. So what have you done to overcome some of these challenges, and what exactly are they?
As I told you, raw material, that's number one. But now how I've solved that, when I'm buying raw material now, I try to buy in bulk and keep them. So that when it's probably if the prices go up, I have something to back up on. Yes, mostly that. And then, of course, after COVID, I could easily move to farmers, to the market and get it like freely. Yes, without any problem. Yes. But mostly I've tried to store. I try to store like enough so that I don't go like, when it goes scarce, yes, I don't miss out.
And the pricing, how have you been? What's the feedback from the people that are buying these spices?
The pricing, how I've determined my prices, of course, I've seen other spices on the market. That's how I try to determine my prices. And my clients are fine with the pricing, yes. Definitely. How I determine, I've gone to the market and checked out other spices, how they cost, the grams, because some of the spices are really packed in very small tins. Let's say like turmeric, it's most of the time you find turmeric like in less than 100 grams or 100 grams, the ones that are packed in tins. So I try to make mine a little bit bigger. Like for example, this turmeric is 120 grams. Yes, and it goes for 10,000 shillings. And you might find something less and it goes for lower, but the gram, yes. So that's how I've tried to package, to price according to package.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What advice would you give to a farmer that's planning to start out in, you know, selling spices or even gardening? You realize it's something that's coming, you know, it's getting into mainstream. Mm-hmm. So what advice do you have for these farmers, and what shouldn't they forget immediately they start?
My advice to farmers who haven't or who want to start farming in spices, I'll really tell them to go for it. Spices are now building up. People are getting to know what their use is. And then also advise on less or no use of pesticides. Or if you use pesticides, use the natural ones. Because these other pesticides, they tend to interfere with the nutrients of the spices. Yes, so that's my advice. Try to get natural like pesticides, yes, and grow more, because spices are coming up. The market is there, the market is growing, yes, market is growing.
So let's talk about competition. Uh-huh. You're in the market, you're sending your products out there, and for the times that I've seen spices, most of them are imported. Mm. I've seen turmeric, I've seen cinnamon, I've seen a couple of tea spices, and these things are imported. Even the raw materials are imported. Mm. So there is so much money lost in that for us, the Ugandans. How are you finding, you know, the market in comparison to what's being imported? Mm. Yeah.
The market, what I would first of all say, our products here, our spices that are locally made, are very organic. They are very, very organic. If they are readily available, I wouldn't advise even anyone to import spices. And then the quality is good as well. We have, at least we are sure of what we're using, we're sure of our soils. Yes. So my clients have really appreciated my spices because they are quality and they are natural. They are quality, and then I try to source from the most natural space. I try that. I try my level best and do that. So compared to the imported spices. And another issue would be probably packaging. Okay, the imported spices may be better packaged than ours because we have limited packages. We have limited really packages. But what is inside is what counts the most. Yes, what is inside is what counts the most. It is organic.
I have seen how from the few that I've seen, yes. I see that they are really, really organic. Nothing is mixed in there. Mm. So how are you able to sell that out to really confirm that these are organic, mm-hmm. like to let your clients know? And how big is your client base so far?
Like in numbers, I could say nearly 2,000. Yes, nearly 2,000. And then another unique thing is that my spices, I try to market them out as a herb, as a natural product to ingest, not like for only cooking. Yes. So because when you see like this tin, this is fenugreek, for example. Fenugreek is used for cooking, but very few people use it for cooking. But it has very many benefits. Like you have cramps, like you're feeling nauseatic, all that. It helps you just take a spoon and ingest. So when I put out my spices, I insist on its health benefits by taking it as a tea other than using it to cook.
Alright, so you've seen that from Carol's story, you can add value to herbs and spices and make it easier for you to access them whenever you need them, especially during this COVID-19 pandemic. Carol has done this for 2 years, and that is how you're able to have a small tin of these herbs in your kitchen cabinet instead of running to the bush at night to get something for steaming. Thank you very much for watching How to Make the Money segment. Make sure you learn an idea or two each time so that you too can make a living. Yeah, indeed, just like Carol, you can be able to make money as long as you decide to add value to whatever you are selling on the Ugandan market. Now tonight on Personal Finance, you will know that the surest ways to waste money is through wasting food. Why should you go to a restaurant and order food you cannot finish and then dump it? Maybe you could decide to share that plate for two people. So these are things you need to consider in case you're trying to save money by saving food. For many people in the world, food waste has become a habit. Buying more food than we need at markets, letting fruits and vegetables spoil at home, or taking larger portions than we can eat, which costs a lot of money. This is how to avoid food wastage and save money. 1. Buy only what you need and plan your meals. Make a shopping list and stick to it and avoid impulsive buys. Not only will you waste less food, you will also save money. 2. Store food wisely. Move older products to the front of your cupboard or fridge and new ones to the back. Use airtight containers to keep open food fresh in the fridge and ensure packets are closed to stop insects from getting in. 3. Understand food labeling. There is a big difference between best before and use by date. Sometimes food is still safe to eat after the best before date, whereas it's the use by date that tells you when it's no longer safe to eat. Check food labels for unhealthy ingredients such as extra fats and preservatives, and avoid foods with added sugar or salt. 4. Be mindful as you plan your meals. When you buy already cooked food, take smaller portions home so you have no wastage, and when at restaurants, share if the serving is too much for one person so you can save the money that would pay for the second plate. And 5. Love your leftovers. If you don't consume all the food you make, freeze it for later use, or use leftovers as an ingredient in another meal. Now, the dollar remains relatively stable despite the skyrocketing fuel prices that we've witnessed all week long. That and more in our Forex and Money Market report. The increasing fuel prices have forced some of the dealers to stock and hoard fuel in the hope that they will sell it later on when everyone has run out. But you know, as a business person, you can never be sure of the future of the market, which requires you to actually play fair. Because what happens then if the fuel is way too much again, and then you have nowhere to sell your fuel? So maybe as a business person, you need to keep thinking and on the lookout for what you are planning to do with your products, especially when they are in scarcity. Thank you very much for watching. I'll see you next week. Good night.